Well, on this Epiphany Sunday, the theme is a familiar one in the biblical narrative and spiritual formation and in our walks of faith. Journey is central to our understanding of God and God's relationship to us. From the time that God called our ancestors, Abraham and Sarah, to leave their homeland and travel to a land they'd never heard of and would not know until they arrived, a land that God would show them. This morning, as you know, we go back to that part of the Christmas story that we've already told numerous times, but that part of the story when strangers find Jesus by following a star that took them on a journey they could never have predicted. This visit of the Magi that shows up in our telling of the story is about these wise men that knew somehow the moment they saw it, that this radiant light in the sky was something more than just a bright star in the night. It's true, there were legends that said that the birth of a new ruler would be marked by some kind of heavenly occurrence, and perhaps they were looking for something unusual. And there were certainly stories that circulated of a promised Messiah for the Jewish people, but these men were Gentiles. So while they might have put that together, the observation of the star and the stories that they'd heard, they probably wouldn't have paid it too much attention. Something happened. The star compelled them to set out on a journey, not knowing where they were going or how long a journey it would be. This was a difficult and dangerous time because Herod was determined to be sure that no one would threaten his throne and his rule. Like all of his subjects, Mary and Joseph were oppressed citizens of the Roman Empire, and his kingship was not a small matter. Herod was the king of all the people. Therefore, by rights and by law, he was the king of the Jews. And so when he heard about a child destined to be a leader, the king of the Jews, he wanted to know exactly what was going on. And when he heard that there were people looking for him, he called the wise men and he instructed them, as the story says, to go find out what was happening and return to him with anything they could find out. Now, Jesus was quite likely not an infant when they found him because they were from far, far away. And even though we compressed the story into one night, they really couldn't have made it there in that one night. But the Magi left, and they went out, and they looked for him. And sure enough, when they found him, they recognized that they certainly could not go back to Herod. And Herod was so angry that he decreed that all of the children in and around Bethlehem who were 2 years old and under be killed. That's the very next part of this story. Matthew tells us that an angel warned Joseph about Herod's intent, and so Mary and Joseph took Jesus and fled to Egypt, where they lived until it was safe to go home. This is an awful part of the story. Herod had all those children killed. It's called the slaughter of the innocents. And you may recognize how it bookends another awful story in the Old Testament, when the same God that is now saving Jesus allowed the firstborn son of the Egyptians to be killed as punishment for Pharaoh, who wouldn't let the Israelites leave Egypt. Jesus' ancestors fled from Egypt, and children died. And then Jesus and his family escaped to Egypt, and children died. And I don't know what to do with that part of the story. I don't know how to reconcile that. These were ancient people, and it was a different time, but I can't believe that our loving God wanted children to be killed for any reason. But in both cases, our ancestors had to leave where they were because of the evil deeds of rulers who were mad with power and paranoid about any threat to it, Pharaoh and Herod. They forced our ancestors to become wanderers and refugees and immigrants, and ultimately to depend on the kindness of strangers in foreign lands to receive them. Now, as many of you know, I spent some time in the Middle East on sabbatical just a few months ago, and I couldn't help but read the Christmas story again, obviously, without having in my mind's eye those places that I just was. Now, it's easy to have romanticized versions of Bethlehem, as in, oh, little town of Bethlehem, but Bethlehem is not romanticized, and it never really was. As you know, I was traveling with a group from Union Seminary, and I've shared with you many of the stories of our trip there, and there were a lot of thin places where the sacred was very, very clear to us. But there were also so many places where we experienced the brokenness and the heartache and the grief of people whose lives are held captive to political and religious and cultural complexities of a land that is sacred to all of the Abrahamic faith. It's the very land that Abraham and Sarah set out for, that was promised to all of Abraham's descendants. It's a land that is not at peace. And as if you have heard me describe, we traveled with a lot of security, and we are very grateful for that. The State Department contacted us daily so that we could tweak our itinerary based on their directives. And we traveled with appropriate documentation of who we were and what we were doing. And when we were in Israel, we had a Palestinian Christian who was our guide, and he was allowed to travel freely with us across all the checkpoints because he was authorized by the government to do so. But for the few days that he wasn't with us and he went home to his family, he had to turn in his credentials and he couldn't come back to us across the checkpoint until it was time to meet us again. Well, the day that we entered Bethlehem, we were one of dozens of tour buses, along with lots of private vehicles who were going through a checkpoint on the West Bank. And we waited in line in the traffic, and we sat there on the bus like we were supposed to do and just watched out the windows. You never knew really what they wanted you to do at a checkpoint until you got there, but you knew to put your phones away, don't take any pictures, don't do anything to call attention to yourself. And we looked at a car on one side of us with a Palestinian license plate and a car on the other side with an Israeli plate and buses from everywhere. The buses were all identified. Ours said Union Seminary, Richmond, Virginia, USA. So you could look around and see that we were with all these people. And on the first day in Bethlehem, it seemed pretty routine. Often at checkpoints, we were told to get out of the bus, take our backpacks. We were personally interviewed and walked through metal detectors while they swept the bus for weapons. But on this day, we were just told to stay in the bus, and two very young female Israeli soldiers with assault rifles got on the bus and questioned the guide and walked around and looked at a few passports and didn't make a big deal out of it. Seemed merely a formality as they carried out their responsibilities. So we went on through, and we stopped at the separation wall on the West Bank. And it towers above the street, and it goes on for miles. It's covered with graffiti. Most of the graffiti are messages from people on all sides expressing their longing for peace. The enormity of it stunned us into silence as we wandered around reading what was written there. Well, we had a full agenda in Bethlehem, including, of course, a visit to the Church of the Nativity, where we waited with thousands of people, pilgrims from all over the world, to see the traditional place of Jesus' birth. Now, it's a far cry from anything the Magi would have found, although it's very likely they might have expected something like this, because it's a very opulent church. It's been there for a long, long time. It's managed by the Eastern Orthodox and Roman Catholic and Armenian clerics, and so the iconography and the symbols have a lot of gold ornamentation and incense that we're not necessarily familiar with in our tradition. But we stood there a long, long time, and it was hot, and it was crowded, and it was claustrophobic. And you go, you get in a smaller and smaller, smaller line till you go to the little tiny room that's really under the church, where there's a gold inlay in the floor where traditionally Jesus was born. And there were literally people in there weeping who had come from all over the world to find this particular place. And it was very moving, largely because we were all there in one place. We spoke different languages. We were from different backgrounds. And yet, all of us somehow had been touched by this person, this Jesus that we then followed and wanted to learn more about. Well, when the Magi went looking for Jesus, they would have not expected to find a child born into poverty. That child that grew up to be the Messiah could not have imagined that generations later in a war-torn land, thousands of people would still be looking for him. That child turned out to be a big disappointment to those whose hearts were set on a military and a political Messiah. And yet, from his conception and birth, his life was set on a path to bring peace by other means. And it seems pretty clear that even his most faithful followers have not been able to bring this about. As I often did when I was in the Middle East, in Bethlehem, I thought, this could not have been what God intended. Why have we not gotten this right? God sent prophets and God sent Jesus to show us how to live. And yet here in the 21st century, we are still trying to figure it out. We are still dealing with power-hungry rulers and disputes over which parts of the land belong to which people. A land filled with checkpoints and walls that have not so far made for any kind of lasting peace. Well, one of the things we did throughout our trip, because this is the kind of trip it was, is we met with people on all sides of various issues there in the Middle East, particularly in Israel. And while we were in Bethlehem, we literally had, in the course of one day, the morning where we spent with Israelis who were Jewish, and then we had lunch with them, and then we crossed over a checkpoint, and we spent the afternoon with Palestinian Christians. And the checkpoint was literally from, as we met with one side and then the other, from here to like Trinity Baptist. We literally went through it, and then we were on the other side. This is how close all of this is. And at that particular checkpoint that we went through safely, there had been a conflict, as there typically is, just a few days before. Two people had been killed and many injured, and we happened to hear from each side different versions of how that happened. Were grenades thrown from one side that then caused the officers to shoot on the other side, or did the officers start shooting that then caused the grenades to be thrown back across the border? We didn't know. Each side certainly believed what they thought was true. Maybe it was all true. I don't know. But what was so obvious was the deep pain that each group felt for the land that they love and all who call it home. And yet, all of these people had hope for lasting peace. We were just, you know, we were overwhelmed, and yet nobody was giving up. Nobody was giving up. Everybody was committed to understanding that God had called all of these people to this sacred space, and surely there is a way to figure this out. Well, I love Epiphany. I love this day. It happens in the new year when so many of us are focused on newness and recommitment and how we're going to do things differently in the coming days. This is such rich symbolism on this day because it lifts our gaze upward and it sets our feet on a forward path as once again watching and waiting and celebrating the birth of the child we've done. And yet we turn our eyes now toward watching and waiting for he who is to come again. This is the part of the Christmas story that to me most gives us hope because it reminds us to look for those stars, those signs that God provides that require our attention and then our response. Those are the affirmations that even in a broken world with all the complexities of all the Bethlehems out there, there are sacred spaces where love wins and hope never dies, and we can see peace on the horizon, the peace that the Christ child came into the world to enact. In that spirit, may each of us carry a little light into the world this year. Amen.